Okay. See, I was supposed to read you a letter. Okay. Before we go on, this goes back to the... I photocopied a letter I got from a 15-year-old teenager. That was in the first issues. Did I put this? I was going to tell you to do that. No. Okay. I think that when you counsel teenagers, I trust when they leave you, you've got a friend. You know what I'm saying? That the door's open, they know you care. I'd like to read this letter, and this kid was 15 years old. His sins could have put him in juvenile hall and later on in prison. I would like to thank you for the help you gave me when I came to see you. I would like to say you've had the best influence on my life that I know of besides Jesus. When I first met you, I was very self-centered and unwilling to repent for my sins that I had committed. So he's coming in, and that's his mindset. Yeah, I want to stay where I am, I want to live where I am. But talking to you helped me be able to say, I'm sorry, very sincerely and repentantly. I would like to say thank you once again. This is one of the young men that's going to be a roommate with me. You never would have believed it. He didn't want to come, didn't want to be there. And when he left, he considers me a friend. Kevin was also in on that counseling thing, and he writes to Kevin. I get a lot of letters from teenagers that were drugged into my office. But when they left, they found a friend. Not a friend in Jesus, but a friend in a counselor. And you can be a teen's friend. And you don't have to be young. I mean, you really don't. Just care. You may be the only person in their life that ever really cared for them, and they saw the love of Christ in you to them, and that you really do care about them. So, you know, if every teenager that leaves becomes your enemy, don't counsel them. Something's wrong. Something's really wrong. Okay. So the music issue, and remember, there are preferences and convictions. And some parents say, I have convictions, you shouldn't listen to Marilyn Manson, but I would rather you didn't listen to this or whatever. You know what I'm saying? And I'm not getting into that. That's a family issue. But I've had kids go squeakier than their parents once they did the music fast. You know, they're going, wait, this stuff is really stirring up stuff in me. It's really wrong. A lot of it can stir up sexual desires. You know, some of that music is very sensual, and the guys are finding out part of their sexual addictions was connected to their music or their music. You know, what came first, the addiction to the music or both together? But they do come. Okay. Now we're going to get into the sexual issues. I want to go with men. I have never counseled men in I don't counsel very many women. The reason I don't counsel women is usually they can get help where they are, and I really am not comfortable in counseling women with sexual issues. I don't think it's right. I don't think it's proper. You know what I mean? For me to get involved in their sexual life, and yet if we don't go there and that's her issue, we missed it. She needs a woman. We don't have a woman counselor. But a good friend of mine, Rachel, sitting right in front of Kevin, Rachel has a degree, she's a lawyer. But she realizes she's limited in being able to counsel. So what Rachel's doing now, she's going to the University of Ohio or somewhere, getting, after having her doctorate in laws, she's going to get a master in, was it social? Yeah, in social stuff, so she can be licensed to counsel. Because she has such a burden. I would love, I mean, Rachel, I've known Rachel since she was 15. Now that she's 17, it's wonderful. But anyway, I mean, Rachel's one of these kids that I worked with their family years and years and years ago. And we've stayed friends all these years. And I've seen Rachel on and off. But Rachel will be wonderful. She's a very pretty girl. Rachel dresses well. You know what I mean? And she even combs her hair and stuff. I mean, girls going to a woman counselor are looking, you know, and they get this, oh, you know, if I follow their advice, will I look like that? You know what I mean? I tell guys, you know, I said, man, you know the reason I'll take my shirt off when I'm counseling you? You'd eat your heart out. I don't want them to think they're going to look like me because they counsel with me. We have fun in counseling. We do. I mean, we could be in the midst of everything and roar with laughter and get back to stuff. You know, I enjoy what I do. If I didn't enjoy, I'd bail out of it, you know. But I enjoy it. But it's so much better for a woman to work with woman. It really seems like that in Scripture, that it's far better for a girl to work with girls. But the problem is there's not that many out there that are trained to do this. I think that's why Kiara is so wonderful. Elaine Pakula. Let me tell you, as sweet as she can go for the throat. You know, I go for the throat. I'm a male chauvinist. You know, you don't really understand. But Elaine is not afraid to get to the issue. You know, let's go to the issue. And she's so sweet, she disarms you. Isn't she a sweet gal? She's just a sweetheart. You know, and gals can do that. You know they love, but they're going where you don't want to go. I'm comfortable to go there, but I need to go there. And that's a woman is really, really super. But anyway, so I counsel a lot of dads, and that would be thousands of dads over the years. And most of dads are in sexual bondages that come to the office. Because that really brings a guy out when he is really trapped. And he knows he can't get out of this. I've never counseled a man in sexual bondage that he didn't start having sexual defeat at 5 or earlier. Never. I'm talking about bondages. We have guys that are being defeated. It's one thing to be defeated. There's a difference in bondage and defeat. There's a difference being tempted and being in bondage. I'm talking about guys in bondage. I want this guy to write a testimony, but I'm afraid I could never put it in my prayer letter. This guy came for counseling. He told me his story. I think it's the most tragic story I've ever heard of a childhood in my whole life. His mother is a movie star, a beautiful movie star. His father is a very famous musician, and people love his CDs. His mother dated Clint Eastwood, that kind of guys. His mother's, whatever you call it, who's they have that gets in movies and stuff, whatever you call that person, agent, also sold her and made money with all kinds of people, and she'd be drunk and all this stuff. When he was 5 years old, the agent molested him till he had an erection and put him on top of his mother. That's his first introduction to sex at 5 years of age. He saw his mother entertaining all kinds of men with doors open and all this stuff. He knew everything that men and women did by the time he was 6. At 7 years of age, the mother decided that since she and the husband were separated, that he needed male figures in his life. Now that sounds so good, doesn't it? I mean, the mom's kind of saying, well, this guy needs male figures. So she gave him to some homosexuals to raise. So at 7 years of age, he's given to homosexuals who were into spiritism. So he saw them doing seances and all this stuff, and now he saw what men did, because they did it openly before him. As far as he knows, they never accessed him any way whatsoever. In fact, he has high regards for one of the fellows who was the first guy to ever show him that he cared about him, but he never did anything. Now, when he was 9 years of age, he goes out on the grass, and he sits there and he says, God, do you know the world's crazy? That was his first prayer, letting God know this is a crazy world. Now, Do you think possibly they may have some marriage problems? The guy has done very well financially. You'd never know. You'd never know by looking what was all going on in his life. Of course, we had to go back. He had to deal with those early issues in his life. But, you know, what was his concept of women? What was his concept of sex? What was all the stuff that he got as a child? Now he's a mature adult and trying to deal with all of the stuff that he just stuffed. Now, he was not a dissociative, but he did dissociate to a degree. But you know what I'm saying? It's a different tree. I dissociated too. You know my horrible childhood? Not childhood. Because I went to Dan. I've told you this before. When we're getting all these dissociated people, and I go, and Dan, I said, psychologize me. I think I'm a dissociative. I must be. I mean, how could you go grow up in all that I went through and all the horrible stuff, and I tried to kill myself at 15? Obviously, I must be a dissociative. But I didn't dissociate. You know why? The awfulness didn't start till I was in junior high. And so the way I dealt with it was masturbation and fantasy. I just trip off in my head. That was really good in class. I did the same thing. I'd be in class, and I would be out there. You know, just deal with it. I was on vacation. I was playing on the playground. I was, you know, whatever. I just learned to not be there. But the bad part of that, even after I saved, when I got married and my wife wanted to deal with issues I didn't want to deal with, guess what I did? I'm on there. I'm preaching a message like Billy Graham or whatever, you know. So I was out here, out there. Another way I handled my dad was when things were so bad, I'd go to bed and go to sleep because he's so drunk and he's being so awful. If I'm asleep, I won't hear him. So when my wife and I would have discussions as Mr. and Mrs. Pastor, guess who would go to bed and go to sleep? Ta-da! I learned how to deal with stuff. It doesn't work too good. I mean, this is not counsel. But I'm telling you, as I learned to deal with issues as a teenager, it slopped over into my ministry as a pastor. So you've got to realize that these things in the past can have a real effect on the present, and you may have to go there. Well, we do go there. I never deal with a guy who's in sexual bondage that we don't go to the very first time that he realized he was sexual. And it's always 5, 4, molested, behind the barn with somebody, or that kind of stuff. Okay. I got notes down the side because I added after I did this. I want to go to the story of the girl that called me from Bible school that demons were having intercourse with her at night. I know this girl, a Christian girl. Committed girl. I couldn't believe this. I mean, it was so hard, but I didn't tell her that. You know, I don't believe it. She tried calling me many times and wouldn't because I knew her. If it was Rachel would have a hard time calling me because I've known Rachel for so many years. She wouldn't want to say that over the phone. You know what I'm saying? It's like, how could I say this to somebody I've known for years? But she told me. Now, I want to tell you something very important in counseling. Anybody. It's not what's happening is important. The important thing is why. Right? I could tell I had a crucifix on the wall, you know, and they probably won't do this. But that's not answering the question, why? Don't get caught up in the what. I need to hear the what, but I need, like those girls, they tried to kill themselves. You know, well, don't take the pills and hide them or lock them up or what, you know. No, why are these girls so miserable they want to kill themselves? Christian girls on the mission field. You know, why is this guy having problems in his marriage? Well, I'll tell you why. We went back to his childhood, his introduction to what he thought was normal living. You know, if that's all you know, that's all you know. You know what I believe for years that Thanksgiving and Christmas times were? Is where families got together, got drunk, played pinochle, and told dirty stories. I'd never been to your house for Thanksgiving. I was only at mine. or my aunt or my uncles. You know what I'm saying? That's all I knew. That's what I thought it was. And you have counselees that had the same thing. That's all they've known. They don't know anything else. It's the only house they grew up in. Teenagers, it's the only house they've been in. They don't know what goes on in someone else's house when the doors are shut. Okay. So I asked this girl, I said, oh, this is tragic. She said, Dr. Logan, it's so terrible. But the horrible part of it, it's pleasurable. You're going to find that in bondages. That's the hard part of bondages. It's pleasurable. And I hate it, but it's pleasurable. And I said, could you sort of tell me the history of this? You know, because it's not normal for Christian girls to be attacked by demons. Boys are too. We have teenage boys that are attacked by demons. I had a kid at one of the Bible schools would call me every time he'd be attacked. He'd be taking a shower, and someone was having anal sex with him, but no one was there. He'd wake up, and he was having intercourse with nobody. This is not, I mean, if you're going to counsel, you will get incubus, succubus stuff because things are getting worse. Our culture is not getting better, it's getting worse, and you're going to have to deal with this, and you have to be comfortable to hear it, even though it's not something you want to hear. Who are they going to tell if they can't tell you? Well, this is what happened, and it fits into the stuff I loved. Well, I love Clinton Arnold. I mean, he's my hero. Although I can hardly understand his books, he's my hero. He's pretty smart. And this other character he brought from Talbot was pretty good too. And a lot of stuff they said, I'm telling you, fits counseling. You know what they were going through? I'm telling you, a lot of the stuff they were saying. Okay, so I asked this girl, could you go back and give me some history to this? And she went back. When she was a teenager, some friends of her asked her if she had these manifestations of the Holy Spirit. She didn't. Well, don't you want to be spiritual? You know, don't you want a shortcut to spirituality? Don't you want a shortcut? That's not what they're saying, but, you know, here's a shortcut. You get this, and you're going to get all this wonderful spiritual stuff. So she was 14 or so. She went to this church, and they went, phew, and she fell over backwards, you know. And then she had a language she never had before. And what's so hard about being falling over backwards? What's so bad about being slain in the spirit? That's it. You're not in control. It's a euphoric kind of thing. When I open myself up to someone else, and if that person isn't trusted, be careful. I just got a call last week of a 14-year-old boy who committed very lewd acts on a 5-year-old. And this incest stuff is increasing. I can't tell you how many parents that I'm counseling that are there because of incest within the family. It's major proportions. What should you do about counseling incest issues? What you need to do in counseling incest issues is you've got to find the laws of your state. If not, you are in serious trouble and may find yourself in legal trouble. What is mandatory requiring of your state? It's not national, it is state level. I can counsel molestations from Nebraska, if it's beyond North Sioux or South Sioux, whatever they call it over there, because it's right across the river. If I counsel anyone in Iowa that was molested or molesting, I am required by law to report it. But if I am counseling people outside of the state and it took place outside of the state, then you don't report it to the state because it was not a state issue. It was happened out of the state. But you've got to know, that's one of the most important things when you get into this stuff, because you're going to be amazed at the increase of this stuff that's going on, this sexual stuff that's going on. The incest stuff is really big. What about perversion? We deal with tons of this stuff. And I don't understand this, but I can tell you this, but I do not understand that often a person's first sexual experience can put him down the road to seek that experience again, especially if it was pleasurable. Now, there may be iniquities, there may be generational stuff, but I'll tell you another thing I can't understand is where two people do the same thing together, and one goes to a perverted lifestyle, the other person does not. You know, is that iniquities? Is that generational stuff? I don't know. But as you work with these people to find out where did it start, what happened, we're out. Did anybody take more than one? Well, get a hold of Jim Gaskell and ask him, because we can run that off again. I'm sorry. I think they had 50 in there. We're out. Totally out. Should they give their name and address? And yeah, he'll talk to Jim about it. Yeah, I'm going to keep going. We'll see what's going to happen. Okay. Pornography on the internet is trapping young men, probably girls too to some degree, but it is increasing. And the problem is, it's not just nudes. It's worse than that. And when I was with Colonel, one of the fellows came to me. He maybe was 13, 14. And he said, I got to talk to you in private. And he began to open up his horrible, evil life, twisted. And I don't want to go into them. But and all the men that I have counseled that are twisted, only one of them did this weird thing. Only one. It's not something you'd figure out yourself. And this kid said, do you ever counsel anybody who does this? And I said, how in the world did you know to do that? It's so weird. It is so gross. It is so yucky. So, I get up at night, I go to the web, and I look at how men do stuff to get an erotic feeling. And then I try it. But in order to do this, he had to steal stuff. And it wasn't cross-dressing. I get cross-dressers and transvestites and all. And cross-dressers and transvestites are not the same. And if you put them together, you're in trouble. And they're going to be upset. There's a whole difference between those two issues. And we get that too. You know, I mean, if there's any evil you can do, it's been through our office. I tell kids, I'll say, if you're doing something evil that I've never heard of, I'll tell you. You know, you're not going to shock me. I'm here to help you. You know, don't hide it, because the thing you hide, you're going to walk out with. But going, and what do? Move. What do parents do? You want to be on the internet? Put the computer where everybody can see. That's at least one step. You know, where it's not, you know, down in the basement somewhere. See, it'd be like having a stack of pornography in the garage and tell your son, don't go there and look. It's the same thing. It's going to cry out to them. And they can pop up without wanting them to pop up. You know Mike. Mike runs the thing here in the black. Mikey. I go in the back and say, Mike, I got to make some airline arrangements. Would you go ahead and do this? And he goes, and up pops a girl that couldn't afford a top of any sort. I said, Mikey, is this what you do back here when none of us are around? He goes, oh, Logan, we got to get her off. You know, he kept pushing delete, and her sisters kept popping up. I mean, he couldn't get her off, and he just turned the thing off. You know, he was so embarrassed because we were going to get airline tickets and got this girl. What about your son that all of a sudden gets this one of these attractive half-naked ladies popping up on the screen? Oh, my son wouldn't look. Oh, really? Let's take him to a doctor. You know, how are guys stirred up? By sight. I don't think the enemy doesn't know that. And it's very hard for a kid, once he's seen something like that, how does he wash it out of his head? And knows it's right there, and he just pushes some more button, and he gets not just seeing naked people. He gets to see how they do things, and then he, you know, education is to practice it. So he's being educated to practice this stuff. I have to get back to this girl. Anyway, I asked this girl, when did this start? Well, she got the Holy Spirit at 14. And the Holy Spirit loved her so much, he began to stimulate her sexually. And she thought, this is so wonderful that she had this wonderful experience in church, and she got the Holy Spirit through being slain in the Spirit, and now she has an ecstatic language, and at night the Holy Spirit comes into her room and gives her these wonderful sexual feelings. Didn't have a whole lot to put together, didn't have much of a Christian background or whatever, you know, just seeking a deeper experience. I'm sure that they haven't used that in their thing of going for more power, more spirituality kind of stuff. And then she realized this can't be the Holy Spirit, and she cried out to God, and she was totally delivered for a number of years. I said, well, then why did it come back at college now? I mean, that's your teenage past. So it's making sense. This is what happened when she was a teenager. She didn't stop it. She was all confused about this and thought it was God giving her the pleasure and all this kind of stuff. Well, she's a very committed girl. And believe me, when I say she's committed, I know her. She's real committed. She has a burden for the lost. Has high principles, high moral standards. She's not dating everybody. She's an extremely attractive girl. Jim Gaskell knows her. Very attractive girl. And what happened is a guy in the dorm, she's in mixed dorms, a guy in the dorm, she met in the hallway, and he smiled at her, very good looking. You know, his muscles are all in the right place. And, you know, he has hair everywhere and on his head, too. And, you know, shook her hand and said he was so glad to meet her. And he's lost and unsaved. And she began to fantasize about him, about dating him. Wouldn't it be wonderful, you know, if he would like her and all this stuff? And it started again. But see, would it have started if she hadn't been there before? I doubt it. But because she had been there, and then when he had done this, she knew that missionary dating is not in Scripture. You know, don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers and getting involved in that kind of stuff. Not she couldn't witness to him, but she wanted him for a boyfriend. In fact, she was thinking about, wouldn't he be a wonderful husband? And she was really, and she said, I'm thinking about him all the time. I think the enemy was helping her, bringing it up, and then it started. So she confessed that it was wrong to fantasize about this unsaved fellow, and not, you know, that there was her attachment. I mean, she was literally ending into a soul tie with a guy that she had no interest in her except being nice. And it was just a horrible connection, and we broke that over the phone and all of that, and it stopped when she confessed her involvement with this guy mentally and all this stuff. And she's doing okay now. But, you know, I'll tell you another thing. The temptations, if you're tempted to do something you've never done, the power of that temptation is not as strong if it's something you have done in your past, and you already know the pleasures of it. You understand what I'm saying? I said, you're never tempted with the same kind of power to do something you've never done. But if you have a lot of past failures in your past, the temptation to go back there is very strong because you already know the power of it and the pleasure of it. I was going to tell you about the time I took all the marijuana in my office. I'm not going to tell you about it. But don't do it. You know, I'm so much want to help kids. He brought all this marijuana to smoke because he didn't know if I could help him. I know his parents are major Christian leaders, but I said, the parents' name, you know this kid. And I took all this, he had a, you know, one of these bags from the grocery store full of marijuana. I don't see how he could smoke the whole thing if he smoked all day and night. But he thought, well, that's what he could do when he wasn't counseling with me, was smoke this marijuana. So I kept it for him. And someone in the law enforcement said, you mean you put it in your drawer in your office? I said, yeah, I want to help the kid. They said, oh, don't. Don't take the marijuana. You keep it. You throw it away. I did have him get rid of it. But anyway, don't take the marijuana. Okay. How do you deal with preteens in sexual bondage? Parents brought a kid to me that I knew, that he didn't know, that I knew, that they found pictures, a 12-year-old boy, had just turned 12, pictures under his mattress of jockey short ads of men. That's not what you want to find as a father. A Christian family. They were sick. They called me on the phone and said, what should we do? I said, don't do anything. You're going to come here. Don't confront him. Just leave it. So the kid comes in to see me. He's 12 years old. And the family wasn't totally true because the kid has heard me speak. They said, we're going there for a family checkup, a family tune-up. And Logan's going to tune up all the kids. So I didn't start with him. I started with his sister. I got him in there. And what do you say to a kid that just turned 12 and say, you know, do you masturbate? Oh, yeah, I'm going to tell you all about it. Yeah, no way he's not going to talk to me. You know, do you have pictures of men that you're hiding? No way is he going to tell me. Let me tell you, 12-year-old are worse than 14-year-olds. I mean, there's a thing up, and, you know, just walks in, sits down. I mean, I like to kind of go for the throat, but not that quick. So I said, Lord, what do I do? You know, I got to see all the rest of the family, and this kid is in a mess. What do I do? You've got to do something. I'll tell you, the Lord will come to your rescue. Cry out to him. The kid crossed his legs, and his pant leg went up, and you could part the hair on his legs at 12 years of age with a comb. I mean, I've seen less hair on a monkey. I said, wow, look at that. He says, what? I said, man, look at the hair in your legs. When did you get 12? Well, I was 12 2 months ago. I said, where? He said, you want to see the other one? So he pulls his pant legs up, and you see this. You can hardly see skin with all this long black hair. I said, man, oh, man, you've gone through puberty. He said, Logan, I'm a man all over. And I said, that's too bad. He started crying. He said, why did you say that? I said, because you have men's desires in a boy's body. He said, Logan, you got to help me. I masturbate, I look at men's pictures, and I don't even know why. You've got to help me. And I hugged him, and he wept on my shoulder. 12-year-old kid. Just opened up right away. But God gave me the can opener. You know what I'm saying? I had to cry out to God. I didn't know what to do. See, I said, I don't have all the answers. I don't even know all the questions. I haven't counseled in this long enough yet. So we talked. We went through all this stuff. We did a lot of stuff on how to take background and all that. I said, but you need to tell your dad. I said, I can't tell my dad I do that stuff. My dad would have never masturbated. I said, I bet he did. I don't think so. He said, remember, this is confidential. I said, yeah. I said, no, you got to tell him. I said, just pray about it. And tell me tomorrow what the Lord tells you. He comes in, and he looks like a hound dog. I said, what happened? He said, I prayed. I said, what did the Lord tell you? He said, tell my dad. Oh. I said, well, good. He could pray with you. I mean, he's there. I wish you could move in with me, but if I had all these kids moving with me, my wife would move out. You know what I mean? We can't have all these teens at our house. You know, I love you. You can always call me. I care about you. So he calls his dad in. I don't know what's going to happen here. He calls his dad in, and he sits on the couch, and he puts his arm around his dad, and this boy was adopted. Put his arms around his dad. This was a number of years ago. He looked at his dad. He said, Dad, I have something very important to tell you. So he's going to tell me. You know, I got pictures on it. He said, Dad, do you ever masturbate? Uh-oh, am I going to kick a dad? You know, what am I going to do here? And the dad said, yes, I did. And he said, oh, Dad, I'm so glad. I'm a mess. I need your help. I need your prayers. Isn't that beautiful? You know, and it's so beautiful. You got a dad that, oh, hey, I don't know what you're talking about, kid. Would you explain it to me? What's the word mean? You know, you know, I mean, it's, I'll tell you, God is such an orchestrator. If you could see the moving of the Spirit, it is so, I mean, why am I doing this at 74 years of age? I could be on a rocking, on a porch, rocking. You know, why am I doing this? Because I love to see what God does in the lives of these people and these kids. It's addictive. I'm addicted to teenagers that are in a mess. I love it. Okay. Let's go down in the warfare issues because we're running out of time. One of the things that I don't think is on here is breaking soul ties. But you have material on breaking soul ties. I think we put it in your notebook, and it's also in here. I wanted to be sure that you got it. There's nothing in there now. But breaking soul ties, that is unbelievable. It's got a call from a family whose daughter is sneaking off with a guy that beats her up. Explain that one. Why does a teenage girl go out with a guy that beats her up, puts her down, says all this stuff? It's a soul tie. And you have material on how to break a soul tie. And parents need to pray it when they see it happening, because you tell your daughter, don't like this kid. Oh, that works. Oh, yeah. Okay, Mom, I won't like him anymore. Okay, I won't like her anymore. You got to start praying that God would sever that emotional connection there, that you know is going to take one of them down the wrong path. You know, but God does not warn girls about lewd men in the Bible. He warns girls about sloths. You know how a sloth gets in your daughter's life? Oh, you don't know how much you're helping me. Oh, you know, this girl's so she's mothering this jerk at 14. You know, he's sucking everything out of her. And then he wants her to prove her love and all that. But God does warn fellows about lewd girls. I wasn't as concerned about my daughters getting involved with some jerk as I was for some floozy to get involved with my son. Because he's 100% boy. You know, and these girls would call the house and want to date him. And I said, Rich, why are these girls calling the house? I said, Dad, any girl that calls the house and wants a date, you go out with her, you can do whatever you want to. I said, I didn't know that. But he couldn't date, and he didn't want to anyway. High school. He waited and got a beautiful woman, wonderful wife, that was pure because he had made a commitment. He would not marry a girl that had been immoral. If he kept himself pure, God had somebody out there for him. And God brought him into his life when he was a youth pastor here in town. Okay, occult practices. You're going to see more and more this thing of Harry Potter. Really, listen, Schnaben, those guys were here talking about all the practice. 1 out of 10 kids that sees Harry Potter is going to try something. And how many million kids have been to the movies? So, you know, that. It's go into Walmart. They have books on witchcraft for little kids and witchcraft for teenage kids in their books thing. I looked. How to do it. How to do this kind of stuff. I mean, Walmart is selling it in their book center thing. So you're going to get a lot more of this stuff going on, and especially as the movies and TV take on more what? You know, I was a vampire for Jesus and all these other things. You know, all these programs out there. And kids are watching it. And usually, I don't know what Buffy the Vampire was like, but probably she was a nice vampire. I don't know. Maybe only sucked blood out of bad boys. I don't know what she did. But you know what I mean? You're going to have all this. Kids are seeing this all the time. It is going to affect them. You know, if you'd have said a cult to me when I was going to high school in Hollywood, California, I wouldn't know what you're talking about. In fact, if you said pornography when I was going to high school in Hollywood, California, I wouldn't know what you're talking about. I never saw pornography in high school. Now, hardly any kid that I see, no matter whose kid they are, has seen pornography. It's been thrown on the road. They picked it up here. They've seen all this stuff already. Okay, another one, and this is amazing. How many Christian kids pray to Satan? If God doesn't answer their prayers, if that girl doesn't like him, if this doesn't happen, they pray to Satan. Once a kid prays to Satan, they better break that. Because usually, after that, if Satan answers their prayer, I tell a kid, there ain't no free lunch. You ask Satan to do something for you as a Christian, and it happens, you are going to pay a price, and you'll be shocked at how many Christian, good Christian kids from good Christian families have prayed to Satan as teenagers. And that's got to be broken. I was amazed. Someone told me to, I never did that. I started asking. I thought, oh, I'm sorry I asked. I can't believe the kids that have done that, that would know better. Okay, spirit guides. One of the ways to find out if someone has spirit guides, I have parents ask their kids this. And then they call on the phone crying when I do, you know, big seminars. And we're talking about little kids. Do you ever hear things no one else hears? Do you ever see things no one else sees? A lawyer's wife called. They live in a huge penthouse thing. A lot of money. The kid's in the bathtub. She asked, 5-year-old kid. Yeah. He said, Mama, I don't see things, but I hear things. What do you hear? Oh, they tell me to go to the balcony and jump off. Well, the mom's crying. She didn't know her son was hearing stuff. I shared this with a medical doctor who was led to Christ by, the guy that wrote the book with you, Neil. I can't think of his name. Doctor, what's his name? With the two boys. Anyway, he led this doctor to Christ that I was working with. And so they lived in a creepy house, and the mom said, you got to ask our kids. I know they're probably seeing things. This house is so creepy, you know, that no one else sees and hear things no one else hears. You got to ask them. Well, they kept coming every year, and every year I would tell parents to do this. So finally, his wife pressured him to do this. And he got the boys, and he said, you boys ever hear things no one else hears? See things no one else sees? No? Half of it. Do you hear things no one else hears? Yes. Oh, no. Yeah. Dad, come out in the backyard. You hear the voices, too. Down the street was a car dealer. Rob, go to bend number one. Go to bend number one. See, Dad? They go, praise God. But I wish it was all, you know, some car dealership down the road. But it isn't. And you'd be amazed of kids that are hearing things and seeing things no one else sees. And they don't want to talk about it, or they were told not to talk about it. Don't tell anybody. I'm giving you special stuff. This is usually younger kids, older kids. But I've asked older kids. We get a lot of calls where kids are seeing eyeballs in the room. They're lit up and all this kind of stuff. Oh, I got another funny one I can't go into. I got a real funny one happen in Singapore. Okay, curses. I was going to tell you about a Mayan boy that was under curses, but I think it's one of my I think it's a video I did for Wycliffe Bible Translators. When I was in Guatemala, an uncle was cursed, and they broke the curse on the uncle. It came to the boy, who was a pastor's son, and he went 12 hours on a bus to get down at the translation center where I was working with Wycliffe Bible Translators, and I dealt with that boy with curses. Negative words visualize achievement. The greatest thing, or the greatest tool that Satan used to defeat me as a teenager was my dad's negative words. You'll never amount to anything. You're never this. You're never that. I operated under that curse for years, way into my second pastorate. I believed what he said. You hear it enough, what? And I wasn't going to let him down. I was going to amount to nothing. And all kinds of struggles and fears that you have, fear of rejection, you know, a fear of tests. Oh, I hated tests. Absolutely hated tests. Because if you take a test, what will you know? Everybody knows that you're dumb. And your dad says you're dumb. Tests will prove you're dumb. So if you don't take a test, then no one will know. Yes. Achievement. Yeah, see, when you go to James, you know, I have a thing that I do just on James, on the words that come out of my mouth. Remember, they're curses, and curses release negative energy toward an object or a person being cursed. That's right out of the 2-volume thing of Hebrew words. I can't think of their names. Clinton Arnold knew what they were. I said, what are those? I have all this Hebrew and Greek help on the floor by my chair when I do devotions. When I pull the books up. I got to look up words. I just do. Just like put on in the armor. You know, I wasn't sure what that meant. No, I knew what it meant, but for some reason I had looked it up. You know what it means? To put on like clothes. So I thank my counselees for not coming naked any day, you know, to the office. But what's he saying? As I put on clothes every day, what should I do? Put on the armor. That's what he's saying. Look in the Greek, you know. You don't trust me? Trust Zodiates or somebody. Okay. Religious spirits. They are the most difficult of all spirits to deal with. People that have religious spirits. It is terrible. What about religious spirits? Here is a key. I cried out to God. Whenever we get a new counselor, he gets a run of people with religious spirits. They only tell them to do religious things. Never negative. Never sin. Just religious stuff. How can you tell someone who has a religious spirit? First of all, if it's a woman, she is sickening sweet. Like too much sugar in my coffee, you want to spew it out. You ever met someone? Oh, it's so good to see you. You go, lady, let go of my hand. You know, there's just something about them that doesn't ring true, and there it is, so sweet. Legalistic, critical, judgmental, religious spirits. And they're critical about, you know, what the pastor said or didn't say or didn't smile or whatever. It's horrible. That's like a knife in my heart. How do you deal with religious spirits? And this has been the key. I didn't know what to do. We did all the counseling stuff, and one day I said, God, you got to help me. I mean, you tell somebody that reading the Bible's wrong? I thought you were a biblical counselor. I mean, aren't you a reverend as well as doctor? I can't believe that. You would say not to pray and not to do this. How do you deal with it? It's very simple. God brought two passages of Scripture to me in it. Clicked. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. What does he do to me? He leads me twice. John 10. What does a good shepherd do? He leads me. What are people under religious spirits? They are driven people. They have to read so long of the Bible. We have guys that have to go back and read, you know, one more chapter because they didn't get it all done before they came. They have to. Or they have to pray 10 more minutes because they didn't finish the full hour that they're supposed to pray. They have to. And it's all religious activity. Remember Wanda, the gal in my book, the first missionary, the first person that ever had demons, and she had them really well, so I got my attention. Wanda had religious spirits. If the enemy had told her one thing evil, she would have known. And she went to Fred Dickinson to put her in a mental hospital. I was in Toronto speaking, and I'm going, oh, no, one of our missionaries is in a mental hospital in a straitjacket. But she had religious spirits, and they were running her life. Things to remember. One, demons can use truth to defeat us. Second is the self-concept of the kids you're dealing with. You cannot live beyond the concept of yourself. When I was vice president of CEF, sitting in my office, the Lord used four or five of us to start a Bible college in Seattle that's still going today. I taught another wonderful Bible college. They asked me to come and teach. I'm vice president of the largest mission in the world. I'm on boards of missions. I've traveled all over. I was sitting in my office, and it came to me that I wasn't dumb. And that wasn't that many years ago. I didn't hear voices. I didn't have to. Why? My dad convinced me growing up that I was dumb. I wanted to run up and down the hallway and say, guess what? You know, the people in the building, we have 132 people on staff there that are there all the time, plus all the people. Hey, guess what? I'm not dumb. They said, we never thought you were. But you know what I'm saying? It's like, wow. But that was the last residue of a negative childhood. I mean negative. And I had to work with my dad mowing lawns in Beverly Hills. Okay? Teens' perspective. Remember, it's not what's happening. Is the real issue. It's what is happening. That is the real problem. Start with why or what's going on there, not just what's happening right now. Get to the root of that thing. See, how I perceive a teenager, how I perceive my situation is how I will react to it or respond to it. My parents are my enemies. How am I going to respond to them? That makes sense? See, I've got to realize this is where the kid is, and I've got to get in there, or I'm not really going to help him. I could take him to the sheep dip, but he walks out. I never got to some of the core stuff. And I have my sheep dipping, and I did a lot of sheep dipping. And I'm sorry I did some sheep dipping. You know, I had to get him through next. Okay. The most difficult prayer a teenager would make, it's two things. James 4. This is they do just before we pray against demonic spirits. And that is submitting to God. What does it mean to submit to God? is for a teen to open up every area of his life to the Holy Spirit and asking the Spirit of God to fill every area of his life. Wiersbe said, any area of your life you don't want God to control, Satan will. They're putting a bullseye in the chest. You can have everything but my dating life. God, you can have everything but my music. And I have him identify every area of the life. And we're almost done, Dan. And opening, they paid extra. And then the last one, and this is what set. Remember the fellow I told you that was hearing all this truth stuff and everything? Was 1 Thessalonians 5:18. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. And he did that because I told him to. Nothing happened. And then he fell on his knees and cried out from his heart to God. And he gave thanks. Giving thanks to God is an act of my will done in obedience to God. Feeling thankful is an act of my emotions that comes as I realize God's actions. When I do this, I'm acknowledging the sovereignty of God in my life. And so he fell on his knees and he cried out to God and he thanked him for all this awful stuff that happened. And you know what happened when he got through that prayer? Something dark left him in that room. And I think we talked the very next day on the phone and I knew he was free. He didn't even have to tell me. I could tell when he talked to me. His parents, immediately when they saw him, realized this thing that had gone on for 5 weeks or 6 weeks was gone. Whatever it was, they had no clue what it was. It was obvious he was free because the joy of the Lord and the peace of God began to fill his heart and life again. Father, there's a lot more stuff we could say and do, and I just pray that some of this stuff may help those that are working with kids. But Father, I know more than my stuff. Kids, I know, teenage boys especially, need some male that would love them just as they are, know everything about them and like them anyway. And Father, I pray that you would give us your love for people. And Lord, I know some of our counselees and some of these teenagers that walk in, I don't know where they could put another body piercing. And Father, you love them. Let me look beyond tattoos, body piercing, navels, or whatever. Strange hairdos. Father, help me to see the heart of the kid and that you love them. And all this weird stuff they're doing is just a front of stuff. Lord, let me look at their heart as you look at their heart. And let me love them and let them know that I love them and I care. And Father, if nothing else, I would never want someone to leave our offices, even if they're not helped. But the one thing they know is that we really care about them. And the door swings both ways. And they can come back at any time. And that we do care. So, Father, thank you that you loved me when I was yet a sinner. And you chose me before the foundation of the world. And, God, I don't understand that at all. When I get to heaven, I'm going to sit down with some Presbyterians and Baptists and you explain it to the both of us. Because I don't get it. I wondered sometimes, you loved me before the foundation of the world because you never would have loved me afterwards. I don't know. You chose me. I wouldn't have chose me. And so, Father, I pray that we would deal with every person that you send to us as your child. And we need your anointing. Need your guidance to do in their life and to cooperate with you with what you're doing in their life. And give us that sensitivity. We ask this in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for his glory, not our success. In Jesus' name.